Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all for joining us in this opening keynote for the second annual Restoring Religious Freedom Project Conference at the Center for the Study of Law and Religion. My name is Mark Goldfeder, and as director of the project, I have the honor of welcoming you all to our center and our law school and moderating tonight's conversation. Before I begin, I want to thank all the people in the center who have made this conference a possibility, our director, Professor John Woody Jr., our associate director, Silas Allard, Anita Mann, Amy Wheeler, Sandra Tilley, Patty Gezzi, Heather Gray, and everyone else who helped arrange everything. Tonight's event is also co-sponsored by the J. Reuben Clark Law Society, and we thank you and welcome you to our center. The topic of this year's conference is law, religion, equality, and dignity. And if that itself wasn't a loaded topic, we begin tonight with some hard-hitting questions right off the bat. We're going to talk about genocide. We figured, why beat around the bush? Let's just get into it. So let me take a moment to introduce our distinguished guests. To my left is Special Envoy Jan Figel. In May 2016, Dr. Figel was nominated by the European Commission to be the first Special Envoy for promotion of freedom of religion or belief outside of the European Union. His role is to work closely with other institutions within the EU, as well as the member states. Dr. Figel is an experienced Slovak and European politician. He's the former European Commissioner for Education, Training, and Culture, and has held a myriad of other important positions and posts throughout his long, distinguished career. He was State Secretary of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Deputy Prime Minister, Minister for Transport, Construction, and Regional Development, and the Chief Negotiator for Slovakia's accession to the EU. It was in that position as State Secretary that Dr. Figel represented the Slovak government in the European Convention, which drafted the European Constitution. It's an honor and a privilege for us to host him at this conference. Welcome, Dr. Figel. To my right is Professor Cole Durham. Professor Durham is the founding director of the International Center for Law and Religion Studies at Brigham Young University. He graduated from Harvard College and Harvard Law School, where he was both the note editor of the Harvard Law Review and the managing editor of the Harvard International Law Journal, because one was not prestigious enough. Professor Durham served as president of the International Consortium for Law and Religion Studies based in Milan, Italy, until this past September. He is co-editor-in-chief of the Oxford Journal of Law and Religion, co-author of Law, Religion, National and International and Comparative Perspectives, co-editor of the Encyclopedia of Law and Religion, and co-author of a four, now five, I believe, volume treatise, Religious Organizations and the Law. To put it mildly, Professor Durham is a father of this field, and it is an honor for us to have him here, Professor Cole Durham. Okay, so we're going to jump right into the conversation. We'll go for roughly 45 minutes, and then there are mics on either side of the auditorium if there are any questions from the audience. And I'll start by just jumping right in, and we'll start with Professor Durham. What practical and legal consequences?
So we were going to have initial statements.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, my bad. There will actually be initial opening statements from both of our distinguished guests before we jump right in. So, with that note, Professor Figel.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Mark, for nice introduction, and thank you all for coming here and creating such a warm atmosphere. For me, this is first ever visit to Atlanta, Georgia, and I was so pleased to discover important places and even more important and nice people here, places which remind your road to equality, dignity, freedom, respect, rule of law, which was not so evident not a long time ago, but quite recently in the 60s in this great United States. Why I mention it? Because I was the one who proposed to speak about century of genocides and also about freedom of conscience with Carl Durham, which is great promoter of human dignity, culture of dignity, and especially freedom of conscience. This law school celebrates 100 years. congratulations, and I wish you even better next century. You did a lot, and I discovered what was achieved here, especially in last decades, and it's a lot of inspiration for many other educational institutions in the States or elsewhere. But outside, or in many parts of the current world, our world, not foreign world, our one globe, this century was full of bloodshed, homicide, or genocides. In June this year, maybe you know, maybe not, German Bundestag, which is important country in the Union, in Europe, in the world, declared, voted on mass atrocities in 1915, 1916, and declared it constituted genocide of Armenian people by then Ottoman Empire. So 100 years it took to say about the fact it was a fact. Different sort of inhuman treatments, war crimes, crimes against humanity, but also genocides happened since that time. Probably the most outspoken and grievous Second World War, Holocaust, but also gulags in the Soviet Empire. I have a name, Jan Figel, which belonged to my uncle. He was killed by secret services in the 50s. Liquidation of people was kind of problem solving. I don't know how many of you speak Slavic or Russian. Stalinist principle was jest človek, jest problem. Jest človeka, jest problema. Is there a man, there is a problem. There is no man, there is no problem. Atrocities of huge mass dimensions happened in Lebanon, in Cambodia, Bosnia, Rwanda. And now we speak about genocide on the territories of ISIS in Syria and Iraq, dominated by jihadists, by militant Islamists. This was the opinion or political position expressed by the Council of Europe, European Parliament, House of Representatives of this country, House of Commons in the United Kingdom, Parliament of Australia. So it's not only my opinion, but opinion of many, and opinion of representative bodies. But still we do not do enough, not only to stop it, but to prevent, because our commitment, according to the Convention on Prevention and Punishment of Genocide from 1948, is about prevention first and then punishment. So we have to learn and to do something more, better, qualitatively, in order to stop this century and to turn the page for more human century. It's not about mathematics, but it coincides. And I hope that such institutions like your law school and center will produce, educate, inspire, mobilize, motivate young and less young people, experts, citizens who may commitments more seriously, and either we adapt convention or institutions like International Criminal Court, but especially we show a good will, strong will to make a difference. A lot can be said at maybe this beginning, but I don't want to speak much, but when communism collapsed in Europe, we call this Velvet Revolutions or Spiritual Revolution or Annus Mirabilis, Miraculous Year, 1989. Then from this country, two basic lines or messages for future came. One was from Francis Fukuyama, End of History. You know it better maybe than me. it was read with a lot of interest in Europe. And the other one was from Professor Samuel Huntington, Clash of Civilizations. I think that neither was or should be the reality, because end of history didn't come. We see how complicated, even dangerous, life becomes now. And I'm sure that Clash of Civilizations is not a necessity. We need more civilization. We need culture of human dignity to prevail. And it is possible. It is important to make it happen. Problem of our time is that we think, we claim, we request, we demand one-sided phenomena, rights, and we forget duties, obligations. We want freedom and more freedom, and we forget responsibility for freedom. It will not work if only one-sided phenomena are claimed for, if we educate next generation for culture of rights without culture of responsibility. And that's why education in full sense of formation of conscience, mind, and heart is important. Openness of minds and openness of hearts. Not filling in, but opening up is the role of teachers and such institutions as this university. Freedom of religion or belief, as we define it, or we say, or we use this term in Europe more than religious freedom, to comprise, to embrace even broader spectrum of those convictions which could be taken as part of Article 18 or expression of Article 18 freedoms from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, is the antidote of radicalization, extremism, and fanaticism. These genocides I mentioned, or many conflicts, were based on different sources of fanaticism: ideological, religious, atheist, political, ethnic. The other side, the other pole of this inhuman behavior is humanity and solidarity. So what prevails depends on us, not on a climate change. It's something in the hands of people living today but preparing tomorrow. Religious freedom, it was very visible, for example, in my country, Czechoslovakia, is a litmus test of all human rights. Because if religious freedom is missing, civil and political rights are missing as well. This is true today in North Korea, in China, although China is changing. Marx declared religion to be opium of mankind. The biggest totalitarian regimes or the dictators hated religion and freedom of religion, like Stalin or Hitler or Mao Zedong or Pol Pot. So freedom of religion is not only a litmus test, but the base of human dignity, because we understand it in connection with freedom of conscience, freedom of expression, freedom of thought, freedom of association, and without that, life is not in conditions of dignity. I had opportunity to be with some of you yesterday in the center of civil and human rights in this great city, commemorating, for example, great man Martin Luther King. And the quote or his idea that injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere is so strong, so appealing, that we have to do more against, for example, anti-blasphemy legislation in some countries. Of course, we need to think about the methods, the ways, but anti-blasphemy is used against human dignity for all, against justice for all. anti-conversion laws in many countries as well. Of course, totalitarian regimes in the name of bright future, new mankind, new man, which is not new, it's just new opium or totality. I want to end by saying, which I think is obvious, this is not about civilizations or clash of civilizations or cultures, because dividing line can go and usually goes through our minds and hearts. Each of us can incline, can adhere to one or the other side. One side I mentioned, fanaticism of any sort, very frequent, very readable. The other side is culture of dignity, dignity for all and everywhere. And in order to find really the place which is human, we need to educate more in order to eliminate support or fertile soil or space for fanaticism of any sort. And it is about fighting against indifference, intolerance, and fear. The three, indifference, intolerance, ignorance, and fear, are allies of evil. And what wins means or depends from what we invest into. I want to conclude by really expressing once again gratitude to Emory Law School, to all of you being not only present here, but acting for the common good to win. I strongly believe that with such commitment, with European Union more focusing, since this year we have a not only new position, but I believe a new momentum to learn from the crisis which is going on, to learn from mistakes of the past, we can make a better century a reality. And I wish you all that. Thank you.
Well, I want to express my thanks as well to Mark and more generally to John Witte and the Center for the Study of Law and Religion at Emory. I've admired the work being done here since Harold Berman and John Witte first arrived in 1985, and there is no question that this center has added great luster to Emory Law School's 100-year history. The century, of course, corresponds, as Jan Figel has indicated, with the century, unfortunately, a century of genocide, the genocide in Armenia, followed by the Holocaust, the former Yugoslavia, Cambodia, Rwanda, and currently the Middle East. Where religious groups are involved in these tragedies, as they often are, genocide is the ultimate and most egregious form of religious persecution. But what, one might ask, has a session on genocide and conscience to do with the Conference on Law, Religion, Equality, and Dignity in the United States today? I mean, I think it's clear to say that fortunately, genocide is a long ways from our doors. But I think that there, we have a robust tradition of liberty, which means I think it's unlikely that we will see such things anytime soon. This tradition can withstand formidable blows. It hasn't been perfect. Although I think we do need to worry about patterns of slow erosion. But I believe the relevance of talking about genocide is threefold. First, respect for and accommodation of conscience holds the key to allowing different groups to live together in just and stable peace, despite the kind of deep differences that can ultimately disintegrate and devolve into genocide. It helps us to know how to live together, and if that can't be exemplified in our country with its rich, if imperfect, traditions of religious freedom, it will be even more difficult to achieve this ideal elsewhere. Second, as UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon has forcefully stated, a atrocity crimes, including genocide, war crimes, ethnic cleansing, and crimes against humanity, take place on a large scale and are not spontaneous or isolated events. They are processes with histories, precursors, and triggering factors which, combined, enable their commission. That is, atrocity crimes represent a descent into darkness, but these often start with relatively mundane patterns of disrespect and discrimination that are allowed to fester, to be magnified into deep-seated hatred, irreconcilable differences, and ultimately explosions of massive violence on incomprehensible scales. Where religion is a factor, the initial steps down this perilous slope can be averted by finding reasonable ways to accommodate conscientious differences. Moreover, it's important to remember that it's not only the ultimate atrocity crimes that we need to avert, but the countless lesser harms that litter the pathway that leads to those deeper tragedies. Third, finding such reasonable accommodations is a price well worth paying. It's a price consistent with our deepest constitutional traditions here and in most other countries abroad, and with commitments the overwhelming majority of nations on Earth have made in ratifying human rights treaties. This is not merely a matter of convenience or national interest. It lies at the core of just treatment among human beings. But it's also a means of promoting countless other goods. We now have extensive empirical data from around the world confirming correlations and likely causal relationships between protection of freedom of conscience and implementation of other civil rights and political rights, women's empowerment, literacy, economic development, foreign investment, per capita expenditures on healthcare, and I could go on. Moreover, as the current flood of refugees and the problems of countering violent extremism make clear, everyone has a strong interest in assuring that countries around the world live up to their international commitments in this area, because otherwise we witness flows of refugees that overwhelm everyone else. Earlier this fall, I had the opportunity of attending a conference at Windsor Castle in the UK, which focused on the travails being faced by Yazidis, which have been condemned by Congress and the State Department and many others as part of a broader genocide perpetrated by ISIL against Christians and Shias. 3,000 Yazidi men were systematically killed by the Islamic State, 5,000 ultimately dying, at least 5,000 women and girls forced into sex slavery, more than 50,000 trapped on Mount Sinjar, subjected to starvation, but substantial numbers ultimately rescued. Besides the sheer horror of what these people have endured, three things stood out to me as I attended those sessions. First, one of the documents we were given was something that just listed sort of decade by decade, century by century, what had happened to the Yazidis. I have to say, it's a miracle that they've survived. So that this last genocide is just one of many such things they have suffered over hundreds of years. I was struck, we were given a document which showed how what the Yazidis were suffering in their particular genocidal experience had strong parallels with genocide after genocide. That is, it really ought to be possible to see these things coming. The third, something that had not really been forcefully impressed on me before, but was the extent to which, when these recurring patterns happen, women in particular have suffered particularly egregious treatment. Rape, sexual slavery, trafficking, all kinds of terrible things that add a new, an additional dimension to what we should be conscious of when we're thinking about these terrible atrocities. Every time we hear about these things, the result is what I think most of us feel coming out of places like a Holocaust museum or other such memorials to man's humanity to man and woman, the never again. And yet, we find ourselves as we see additional cases saying, why not again? It's happening again. How do we sort of avoid that? Well, I think a lot is being done. It's hard to know, it's hard to fathom irrational processes. There is a natural response in terms of turning to various kinds of force. This is often necessary and required, but it has to be exercised in ways that don't make things worse, which is one of the problems that if one comes at these problems purely with a security mindset and not a human rights mindset as well, things can go from bad to worse. The relevance of freedom of conscience in this context is it really provides the deeper context for making just peace and stable peace possible. I think we live with such, it is the foundation of our American civilizations in ways that's easy to take for granted. And other rights emerge, we get concerned with these, but we often forget the importance of this foundational framing principle of our lives that makes it possible to live together despite deep difference. After all, what we've learned is that what's required for a stable peace is not homogeneity, but it's the fact that different groups internalize notions of freedom of religion or belief, freedom of conscience, and recognize and are willing to stand up for it for other people. Accommodation is the real way of showing the kind of respect that's necessary. It's not enough to just say, oh, we should be tolerant. We have to show it in actions. I think the underlying problem that we're facing around the world is that people feel threatened, people fear. Minorities feel threatened. Majorities also feel threatened. And one of the critical things is finding ways to reduce the threat level. And the notion of freedom of religion or belief is one of those notions that makes that possible. I think we have a problem of maybe reciprocal slippery slopes. I don't know quite how to describe this. But often what we see going on in our own societies, we look at polarizing problems like some of the same-sex marriage issues or some of the issues that are coming in the train of that issue. People take positions out of fear that their positions will slip further. One side has, the religious side has one set of parade of horribles, the LGBT side has another set of fears. In some ways, what's really critical is finding ways to reduce the fear, to get over the fear so that we can find ways to live together, even though we're probably not going to come to agreement or consensus on some of these issues. We need to find ways to live with deep difference. This is really one of the fundamental insights that lies behind religious freedom in the first place, goes back to Locke, the recognition that just as you could get some stability by having homogeneity, you could get even more stability within limits if you would respect the rights of all kinds of people. One of the things that we're seeing in the society around us is a kind of sense of things falling apart, things that we thought for a while we were approaching the end of history, not that time would end, but that we had found some solutions that should work and should work permanently. But we're seeing those begin to come unraveled. We're seeing signs of it with sort of the tensions in our current elections. We're seeing it with things like Brexit. I was at a conference a few days ago in which someone pointed out that in about 2007, their expectation was that all of the former Balkan Yugoslavian subcountries would be brought into the European Union. They hoped it would happen by 2014, and they thought that would be a very good year because that could mark the century ending the First World War. Well, that was a nice thought, but things are going the other way, and we see all kinds of tensions. We see tensions in the transatlantic relationships. It is Trump, I suppose, but who would have thought that people would speak about unwinding NATO? Some things that have sort of helped stabilize Europe for two generations. I think we need to watch these things. We see some things unraveling. We can make choices. We can make a difference. I think it's vital that we find ways to make a difference and that we find new ways to apply this old and now time-tested notion of freedom of religion, freedom of belief, freedom of conscience that can make it possible for people to live together with deep difference.
Thank you. I want to thank you both for those very thoughtful opening statements, and actually just want to take a moment and offer one more set of thanks to God and to the United States. We live in a very politically charged country, especially this week, and it's important to stop and realize, as you mentioned, that despite what you might hear in the media, we don't really have a law and religion problem in this country like other places do. There are hard cases on the margin. 250 of such cases have gone to the Supreme Court, but no one's cutting off anyone else's head for not believing or saying the right thing religiously, and that's a really important thing to be thankful for. Rabbi Moshe Feinstein was perhaps the greatest decisor of Jewish law that ever lived in the United States, and in a famous responsa piece actually urging people to go out and vote as part of their civic duty, he wrote that this is a Medina Shel Chesed, a country of benevolent loving kindness. And that's the kind of thing that never existed before, and it's important for us to always be aware and thankful for it, and so I just want to raise that before we begin this conversation. Professor Durham, you mentioned, and it's obviously true, that it's hard to make sense of a topic like this, and so I want to try and use the law as one possible frame of reference for understanding genocide. Both you and the Special Envoy mentioned the idea of labeling and how important it was to call the tragedy 100 years ago the Armenian Genocide. What are the practical and legal consequences that flow from labeling a particular conflict or tragedy as genocide?
Well, I think that at one level it's interesting. I looked back at John Kerry's statement when he was speaking in March and speaking out and criticizing what was happening, what ISIL was doing as genocide. And it's significant that he, at that point, said that, he was cautious. He had waited for evidence. And even then, he reminded us that, on the one hand, while he was saying, Daesh is responsible for genocide, this is a quote, against groups and areas under its control, including Yazidis, Christians, and Shia Muslims. Significantly, he pointed out, and he also said, I am neither judge nor prosecutor nor jury with respect to the allegations of genocide, crimes against humanity, ethnic cleansing by specific persons. Ultimately, the full facts, he said, must be brought to light by an independent investigation and through formal legal determination made by a competent court or tribunal. So at one level, we wait for those kinds of formal adjudications. But I think it was significant, some of the things he pointed out that could be done. States who signed the Genocide Convention have certain duties to enact national legislation that punishes genocide committed in its territory and does not allow a defense of acting in an official capacity. to ascertain the location of an accused individual and arrest him, cooperate with extradition requests, send disputes to appropriate courts. I think, interestingly, in the Bosnia and Herzegovina case versus Serbia and Montenegro, after the genocide in Srebrenica, states are obliged to take, quote, all means reasonably available to them so as to prevent genocide so far as possible. This is interesting to try and think about exactly how broad that means, but it suggests that there may be genuine international responsibility. And I think countries are really feeling that. It's said that Bill Clinton thinks that one of the real tragedies of his administration is not having intervened earlier in Bosnia, that a lot could have, or Rwanda, a lot could have been done. I think a determination of genocide underscores even more starkly the need for a comprehensive and unified approach. It makes it easier to encourage the flow of emergency aid to those who have been displaced and survived, the need for material and psychological aid, supporting care for victims of gender violence, and to work on reductions of the tensions that the security forces can elicit if they're not careful, if they're not well-trained, if they can't help diffuse things. So, I mean, I think there are some things that don't happen just because you call something genocide rhetorically. But there are a number of things that are set in train and that can help.
Regardless of what you call this kind of tragedy, I'll ask the special envoy, what are the best practical steps can be taken to avert such tragedies? And how effective have international norms been and institutions been in this regard?
We haven't been very effective. Return back to the point which was as a main message used 70 years ago. Maybe you recall 1946, October 1st, verdict in Nuremberg over Nazi criminals. And the term never again was a commitment, never again. Reality was again and again and again. So if there is no political will to follow commitment, then we don't have a real credible answer. I wonder why, one can ask. I got sometimes questions, for example, from UK media, why UK government doesn't follow what was said before. Boris Johnson, as politician, as mayor, was very clear, as Minister of Foreign Affairs, less. If Parliament in this country and even foreign secretary says it is a genocide, it constitutes a very concrete legal procedure. And especially for those who have power, who are permanent members of the Security Council. In law schools, we learn a lot about the mistakes and weaknesses and loopholes of the League of Nations. Price was extremely high. Now we have United Nations, and we speak again and again and again about genocides. I think problem is lack of will, political will, to make a different step, to do something preventive. And of course, there are some also legal weaknesses, because the convention was defined more than 70 years ago, adopted now then in 48. And after so many years, after we see now very specific threats or non-state bodies, like groups of ISIS, we should adapt. There are some ideas, there are some even proposals, for example, to establish ICC for international terrorism, a special body for special type of crimes. We should think about innovation or amendments, improvements of the classical original genocide convention. But nothing will replace the real commitment, the real will. If there is a will, there is a way. If there is no will, then we find excuse and debates. But I want to tell you that silence helps perpetrators, and silence hurts victims even more. So I hope that our governments will follow our parliaments, and parliament should follow people. I think that people would like to see a different future, whether we speak about our countries or our neighborhoods. Near East, which is better description than Middle East in my eyes or my mind, is a geopolitical gravitational center, Schwerpunkt in Deutsch. Continents are meeting there, major religions, major interests. And if we don't care or do enough for stability and peace in that part of the world, we suffer, and the people suffer there, of course, even more. So improvement should be done in both political and legal terms. But then what is decisive, even if we have improved instruments, is a real political will of those who possess power or represent our democracies to act accordingly. And the first step is prevention, and then punishment. If there is no justice in these territories, how to speak about stability, reconciliation, and future? Peace is fruit of justice. Peace is fruit of justice. And if the court is not acting, even not investigating, not accepting facts, then difficult to speak about justice. Martin Luther King, if there is injustice anywhere, it's injustice everywhere. So I'm only appealing because I don't have power to do more, but awareness raising, education, mature citizenship, not only in the country, but also in the world, we are citizens of this world, should be our response. Improvements are possible, but will never replace real commitment of mature people and their mature leaders.
To take it in a slightly different direction, come from a different angle, Professor Durham, how broadly should the conception of conscience be understood, and who can assert conscientious claims?
Well, this is very important in this context, because we need to, if we're thinking about the top of the slippery slope that can slide down to these tragic situations, we need to be able to deal with normal situations and start some of the tension from getting off the ground. And I'm deeply convinced that by protecting conscientious beliefs, we can make a major contribution. Now, I think it's helpful to use the word conscience, and that is a term that's in the international instruments, because it's quite broad. That is, it includes religious beliefs, but it can also include other kinds of convictions. Mm-hmm. It's interesting, the phrase that's typically translated in the UN is freedom of religion or belief. Or belief part came from the Russians, actually, and it was really a term that meant something more like conviction. So it's not just any belief, but it could include religious beliefs, other kinds of worldviews, other life stances, so that it's quite inclusive in that sense. And I think that one of the reasons this is so important is that conscience is so closely tied to the core of dignity, so that it needs to be broad enough to really protect that sense of dignity and help people feel protected. It needs to protect the capacity human beings have to adhere adhere to their inner moral compass. We need to respect the fact that different people will respond differently to different types of things. They will have different conscientious interpretations. But if it's not respected, then something fundamental fails in democracies. A democracy is a means of trying to pull together the conscientious beliefs of a lot of different people. But if there aren't conscientious inputs into the system, if there isn't vision, the people perish. And I think that, so what we need are broad conceptions. We need to, let me stop there.
Okay, well, to go from the broad to the very specific, how do policy initiatives in this area relate to the refugee crisis in a very practical matter? How can sensitivity to conscience enhance responses in that domain?
Of course, people fled from the country for various reasons, but very, very visible now, especially in the area I spoke about repeatedly, Middle East, is war conflict, and even systemic murdering or persecution, which is existential, liquidational, extermination of certain groups, or because this was factually testified or showed by many examples. Well, I mentioned it repeatedly because today these facts are demonstrated, manifested online, immediately, in time. Before, it was difficult to prove. Evidently, on European continent, the influx of migrants is connected with the situation in the neighborhood, which is Middle East, Northern Africa. Of course, part of them are economic migrants. They simply look for better conditions. But many of them are refugees, and of course they deserve treatment according to international law. So the answer is, of course, to stop atrocities, to stop war, bring peace. And again, I come back, peace is fruit of justice. So we should think about justice. But we also should think about lasting peace or perspectives which, for example, must be based on reconciliation. It cannot be just appeasement or armistice. For example, faith-based reconciliation is something what could bring a difference. We need leaders who are able to think about common good and also act accordingly. I hope that this is not so theoretical, but very practical, because Europe was full of mass graves, bloody borders, repetitive wars, revenges, and now we're seen as a model. When you speak to people in Africa or Asia, or I was at four Chinese universities, they give parallels now, and I am glad, to our motto or our narrative, unity and diversity, with their Confucian ideal, saying or speaking about harmony of differences. Fine. So not uniformity, but unity based on differences, because that makes sense. We all are different. We all are original, but we all are equal in dignity. Migration is a huge topic. It's civilizational. United States have a lot to say about it. But we should do our best to respond to the challenges of the time. And many of them are lack of basic justice or living conditions. Of course, there are many causes we cannot influence so much. But what strikes me that many countries simply close their eyes or minds or borders and think that this is for somebody else to solve. We are living in one world which is more and more interconnected, interlinked. And for example, what I said before, for me, countries like Israel, Jordan, Syria, Lebanon, are near our neighborhood, cradle of our cultures or civilization even. I plan to visit Iraq. It's so important country for the whole world. And we should help this country to live in peace and perspective. So this approach, positive, constructive, means rational solidarity, and it pays back. Reasonable solidarity, well-organized solidarity, is a win-win. It's not one way, it's win-win.
Let me also just sort of pick up on that slightly. I think, I mean, the refugee crisis has really unbelievable proportion, dimensions, 65 million refugees, something, it's interesting to remember that only about 10 million of those are from Syria. Syria, 6 or 7 years ago, had a population of 22 million people. These are huge numbers. And there are some real questions dealing with this vulnerable group. A lot of the work is done by religious or faith-based organizations. They need to have sensitive ways of dealing with vulnerable groups. It's also true that refugees often really need to be able to lean on their religious beliefs. It's given to me new meaning to why it is that freedom of religion or belief is a non-derogable right even in times of emergency, because in times of emergency, people may need particularly to lean on religion. But as people go into new contexts, they may undergo rethinking of religious premises. They may be converted. They may have different kinds of experiences. And one of the practical problems we have right now is it's very difficult because there's a tendency for people processing refugee claims and asylum claims to assume that any sign of religious change is somehow illegitimate, a sign of insincerity or something like that. Could be, but may not be. But certainly we have to find ways to show respect, both in these micro situations, even realizing just the sheer massiveness of the numbers that are being involved. But paying attention and respect to people in this vulnerable situation can do some significant things to help opening up pathways for people to be able to return to normalcy.
Again, very interesting. And I want to note that I want to make sure to give time for the audience to ask questions. So we'll use this opportunity to ask one last question to both of you before we open it up to the audience. And playing off our last discussion here, I wanted to ask about American and European policies that contribute to enhanced protection of freedom of religion and belief, whether it's refugee crisis or other particular policies. How do the responses in the area compare to each other? Are there things we should be learning from each other? Are there ways that joint efforts can have some kind of enhanced synergistic effects around the world if we were working more together?
Maybe I'll start as a freshman. I'm in my position since May, which was a very special time because in May we celebrate Truman's Day, which reminds 9th of May 1950 declaration, which was surprising and very efficient to change the paradigm or the way how European cycles have been developing. And since that time, we commemorate Father of Europe, the only politician who had got this title, Robert Schuman. There are many, of course, who deserve this, but that time I was nominated. It was a very special time because it was not done in Brussels, the press room, but in Vatican, in Rome, where the Pope was awarded by Charlemagne Prize of the Emperor Charles the Great by European Union, by the institutions, in recognition of his contribution to solve, to heal, to show example, solidarity, and really humanity vis-a-vis refugee crisis. So Even nomination and invitation was very special. Why I mention it, because European Union needs to feel, to share deeper togetherness, that it's not only economic community, it's not bunch of traders, it's not just, you know, space. It's a human community where we feel at home, we share a lot, we know what unites us. And this is a bit missing. Brexit is one of the examples, there are many other problems, but... And Schuman in his small testimony said, Europe needs a soul, spirit. So I hope that somehow we come to the point now with our 60th anniversary that we need also a deeper human dimension, respecting cultures, religions, diversity, and promote really humanity. We speak about freedom of religion or belief, which is a broader concept, a bit different from US. My nomination is very fresh. There is also intergroup in the parliament, which was organized since 2014, again, very short time. US approach is a longer. Of course, I don't want to speak about history, but since 1998, you have Act on International Religious Freedom. 18 years means, I hope, maturity with the Congressional Commission and then executive branch in the State Department. I'm working and meeting quite frequently with David Saperstein, ambassador at large, and his colleagues. Europe is different because European Union doesn't have sort of federal power. We have a treaty where religious legislation is respected on the national level. So the system in Germany, in Greece, in United Kingdom, in Slovakia is different and national. What we do on European level is recognition of the contribution of religions, churches, religious communities, and non-confessional associations to European integration. And we provide a regular, transparent, open dialogue, annual dialogue with these churches and communities. And everything else is done, solved on the national level. Here the situation is, of course, a bit different and you know it better, but although we differ in a way, we are very close in working on freedom of religion or belief as the principal, important, universal value for our world. And I'm glad that this awareness, this tandem or cooperation is growing. We have now a so-called contact group, a group of like-minded countries which are acting and active in this area because member states are holders of the union or sovereigns to run foreign policies, where we coordinate, we try to work together, especially in some priority countries or areas. My role, to conclude, is to promote freedom of religion or belief through area or agenda of international cooperation and development assistance, to bring this criterion and objective more to the forefront, to use our programs, projects, bilateral and multilateral agreements really more in line with freedom of religion or belief. And in that respect, I'm really happy that we can voice the voice or work together with American friends and partners.
Well, let me just say, I'm reminded, as I think about differences between American and European approaches, of a statement made by a friend of mine who served in the State Department at one point. He said, one of the problems is that Americans lead by irritation. We're a little bit more prone to sort of name and shame mentalities. And I think there are some values with the sort of European greater graciousness, a little bit more gentle approach sometimes. I've been in a lot of meetings over the past couple of years where both sides of the Atlantic have been trying to figure out ways to work more effectively together, because there's clearly a recognition of synergy. And frankly, there's anxiousness to learn better ways and more effective ways to promote freedom of religion or belief globally. And we see that in the proliferation of offices like that now held by Jan Figel in Europe. I could point to a number of different things that are happening. And this reflects the growing understanding that there are real problems if we don't address freedom of religion or belief. We don't address freedom of conscience. One of the difficulties, one of the tricky things in this area is that the problems in this area are often sort of slow, burning, smoldering kinds of problems. And if in any State Department, on any foreign service officer's desk, if you have a task, you will have things like disappearances, torture, other kinds of things that will inevitably be more urgent, take your time, fill your time. But if we don't have some mechanisms that address the freedom of religion or belief, the freedom of conscience issues, these can get out of hand and lead to resentments and perceived attacks on dignity that can, in the long range, come back to haunt us. So we really need some institutions that help keep this fundamental right in view, and that people are continually working on that, working, of course, on other rights as well. I think we urgently need to find things to do. It's really impressive to me to find different ways that people can approach things. It's clear that Europe can work in some countries that the US can't work well with. We've had the story recently of people talking in both Europe and the United States about North Korea, talking about the problems. They can't see any way to do anything because they can't even have diplomatic relations. But they mentioned this to some people from Brazil. Brazilians haven't solved the problem, but they were able to at least go visit. So we need to find ways of reaching through different channels, because different channels may have different levels of effectiveness. We also need to find ways. There are limits on how far people can be moved, on what people can be pressed to do. I think we need to find ways of being more insightful about practical things that really will make a difference. And sometimes you find those methods not so much by saying you're doing something wrong to another country, but by saying, can we sit and find out what is the real problem here? Are there some resource needs? Are there some other needs? Are there some things that really would make a difference? And I think we need to work on finding those things. And I think the teamwork that one's seen between US, Europe, and a number of other parts of the world will contribute to those efforts.
Thank you. I want to give our distinguished guests a chance to catch their breath, so I'll just thank them right now again for their wonderful contributions. We have just enough time for a couple of questions from the audience. There are microphones in the stands, so if you can take just a second and find your nearest microphone, we will have to call on you. Professor Hill.
Thank you very much to both distinguished speakers for insightful, engaging dialogue. My question is this: when future generations come to deliver their verdict on this past century of genocide, how will religious organizations be judged? As peacemakers, as warmongers, or as ineffectual bystanders?
I I've been nominated. That's obviously a wonderful and very difficult question, because I think the answer is, unfortunately, all three. Clearly, if one thinks about some of the tensions in the former Yugoslavia, there were clearly clergy on both sides that were making things more difficult. I guess what I would say is that, well, you do see the ambivalence of the sacred in this way. I think this points up the fact that in many situations, religious players, religious leaders are in a really unique position. They're often more trusted than government officials. They often are linked to grassroots people more directly and in ways that can really make a difference. I was at a conference last week in which someone, a former director of USAID, talked about Rwanda and Burundi, and who knows exactly what will happen in Burundi. I take it there are ongoing problems. It's the same basic ethnic divide. But where in Rwanda, sometimes the clergy may have been bystanders or may have been fomenters, there have been at least some instances when religious leaders in Burundi have really tried to take to stop momentum that could have replicated genocidal conduct. So I think it's a really good question to ask about religious leaders. I think one of the surprising things is that, you know, most religious leaders really aren't trained, ironically, to be peacekeepers, except maybe in domestic settings. That is, they're trained to work in pastoral settings, and there are different kinds of issues in conflict resolution. But I think that religious leaders can play a critical role in bringing about peace. I think I've seen situations where religious leaders can help play a significant role in the aftermath, and certainly religious factors. One thinks of Desmond Tutu in South Africa, for example, as someone who made a tremendous difference in the way South African post-apartheid reconstruction has happened. So that's sort of the best I can do.
Yeah, I think that this is not only interesting, but also very important question, because many times religious leaders have greater power than political leaders, whether in time or in scope. Ministers are coming and leaving, and many imams or bishops or cardinals are there and make their say and influence. And of course, we need to distinguish and to differentiate, and I hope that we understand that if somebody fails, it's not majority, or 1 out of 12 is not 11 out of 12. I just mentioned example of the Pope being awarded by the European Union. This doesn't happen usually, because it could be seen that Union is not secular enough, but he deserved it. And I listened in Italy when I was in Rimini meeting, when Grand Mufti of Croatia, of Zagreb, praised Pope as example of solidarity. I want to praise many leaders, for example, in Jordan, I was there last month, for their initiatives, activities on international scale. Maybe you know Amman message, which is very strong, understandable. It represents up to 40 religious leaders. There is International World Week of Interfaith Harmony from Jordan Initiative on the United Nations. There is Marrakesh Declaration from early this year, very important piece of position or appeal to Muslim majority countries. I hope something is changing because there is genocide, or in spiritual dimension we can say martyrdom. First time in 2000 years, Patriarch of Moscow and Patriarch of Rome has met in Cuba. I think because of bloodshed, because of, and this was important part of the meeting. My nomination in European Union came after the EP, European Parliament resolution on genocide, and inter alia requesting European Union to establish position of special representative for religious freedom. What I want to say, I hope that this genocide brings also fruits of martyrdom of many, because this can make things or evolution different. And fortunately, there are many religious leaders who understand that freedom of religion means engagement, responsibility of religion, not only to enjoy or to ask for or request, but to act in responsibility for freedom and humanity. We learn together, and I hope that they will get it. Look, soon, after next year, I don't know how to say it, we will commemorate, we will remember the beginning of 30 years religious wars in Europe. And it ended with the international system of balances, Westphalian system, peace treaties, but based on unjust principle. Cuius regio, eius religio. Then who rules decides about the belief or religion. This is what caliphate tries to establish on one territory. So we don't need, we humanity, to repeat tragic lessons, whether from last century or 3 or 4 or 5 centuries ahead, before, but to move towards more human time. And religious leaders, I underline and finish, have responsibility for that. And the rate of responsibility is based on the rate of influence. And their influence is frequently bigger than those elected in the parliaments or in governments. Rate of responsibility is given by the rate of influence.
That's obviously a wonderful and challenging question. I just want to push back a little bit on the framework. I would hope that the future generations that were doing the judging wouldn't necessarily look back on the effectual or ineffectualness of the bystanders, but on whether or not they tried to help. And I would hope that, I think here of all those who were martyred during the various genocides that we've discussed, whether or not they succeeded, whether they tried or failed, but those who attempted to do good in the name of religion would also be remembered for that good. We have time for just one more question, and then we're going to call it an evening. Professor Corvino.
Thank you. Thank you both for your comments, and thank you, Mark and the Center, for hosting this important dialogue. I was wondering if we could go back to the organizing question of the dialogue. A century of genocides is better accommodation of conscience and answer, because as I was reflecting on your remarks, it occurred to me that the people committing the genocides were in some sense acting from conscience, right? ISIL is acting from conscience. We may think of it as a malformed conscience, but it's their judgment about what they ought to do and what God wants them to do. And so I was wondering if you could reflect a little bit on the question of whether better accommodation of conscience doesn't necessarily mean more accommodation of conscience. Say more about the better in there and what that means and how we handle these cases where conscience and people acting on their conscience cause great harm.
I think I should be able to let him take this one. I guess one thing I would say is there implicit in the question is a recurring notion that a lot of the violence that we see in the world is really religiously based. And I think a partial response to this, a candid response would indicate, yes, that is part of the problem. And I'm one who believes that part of freedom of religion or belief, properly understood, is it serves as a kind of filter because it does allow intervention against certain kinds of bad conduct. But I do think we need to be cautious about assuming too quickly that religion is the cause. I mean, it's one cause, but we have to remember that in some ways, some of the most devastating things that happened, such as the Holocaust, the purges in Stalinist Russia, I mean, these things happened not because of because of religion, but because of other kinds of things in the background. And even the notion that religious liberty emerged from the cauldron of the European wars is a little bit too quick. It may be that what was really going on is that the centralizing drive to create stronger national governments was creating increased restrictions, which people were resisting in various ways. There's some of the work that Brian Grimm has done suggests that it is not clash of civilizations, it's not clash of religions that causes the problems so much as increasing regulation or restrictions on religion, which pushes religious believers into a corner from which they will react defensively. Now, it's a complicated picture, but I think that we need to remember that as well. But I do think what's sort of right about the question is we do need to think conscience isn't an automatic good. It needs to be respected, cultivated. But we're also spending a lot of time these days trying to figure out how to counter violence in the name of religion that comes from sectors that states have legitimate interests in controlling.
Yeah, I didn't want to skip the answer, but to give preference to Cole, because I respect his contributions from the angle of conscience. Freedom of conscience, but this is not about religion, what you speak about. It's about abuse of religion. It is pure fanaticism. And if we mix fanaticism with some other phenomena, then we are lost, because it is against humanity what perpetrators do with their victims. And there is no excuse for that. No excuse for that. And that's why United Nations should act. And where are these countries? Where are those who can start the procedure? Permanent and non-permanent members of the Security Council, which has power to draft or decide upon international law or General Assembly. So that's why we need committed and willing representatives and representations. Abuse of religion. If we don't understand religions properly, if we don't understand also the abuse of religion, we don't understand what's going on in our world, in our current world. So there is no excuse for terrorists. Whether religious or political, no excuse. And it's not about conscience. This is not about conscience and consciousness. This is about inhumanity and blind actions or acts of criminals. So please be aware that it happens. Sometimes they use religion, but when you read Aman's message about 8 schools of Islam, everything is against the arguments of ISIS. Nazis acted not only about according their conscience, but according the laws, valid anti-Jewish legislation. So they followed, they observed laws. They got power by referendum, people's will. But this was against humanity. The acts against humanity cannot be excused by silence or even misinterpretation. That's why we need to form conscience in service to humanity. Minds and hearts which understand common good. Common good. This is not against anybody. This is for all, because it's good. And good is good for everybody. But these are ideologies trying to use, to deform, to somehow revert what is traditional or what is believed by or shared by, mostly using ignorance or indifference for their aims. So once again, education for humanity, education from the past, or historia magistra vitae est. I believe that projects of this university, with the museum, with those who believe that we can learn and we should learn, the 20th century could mean more mature mankind, including United States, including European Union. I think we have a tremendous role to play in this time with all the potential which this country represents, knowledge. So I hope your elections will bring good answers to these questions. Our decisions in Europe, in Britain, in Slovakia, which is presiding over the Council, first time ever, will show that we are further on the road. Thank you.
I just want to reflect back on a very practical answer to your question, which is, I think the short answer is, there is a short answer, which is my rights end where your nose begins, and there is, in fact, a very fine limit on the rights of conscience, and those limits have to do with harm. President Obama, when he was running the first time and was asked these kinds of questions, he liked to explain it using the story of Abraham and Isaac at the binding of Isaac. And he would say, well, if any of you walked outside and looked at the top of that building and saw an old man raising a knife to slaughter his son, regardless of what he told you about religious tradition, you would call Child Protective Services, because we can't hear that word of God. And what he meant by that was that nowadays, in the face of harm, we don't give credence to claims of conscience. And that's one approach, and I think that's a fine approach. But there's another approach as well, which is a bit more nuanced, and I think might be a bit more helpful in these areas, which is Professor David Schatz of Yeshiva University writes about that particular story that people tend to miss the climax of that story. The climax of that story is not Abraham raising the knife. It's God saying, no, stop. And it's the story of not having religious extremism that leads to harm. And people misread that story constantly, and that leads to these vagaries and problems of conscience. And so that doesn't mean that we have to go and paternalistically tell people what their religion says. But what it means is not just ignoring conscience, but finding those pockets within various religious traditions that allow for what I would call better accommodation, and approaching those from an education perspective, from a religious as well as a secular perspective, and that might lead to a better form of accommodation. I want to again thank the J. Reuben Clark Law Society for their co-sponsorship, the Center for the Study of Law and Religion, and all of you for participating in this wonderful conversation. The conversation continues tomorrow morning right here, beginning 8:30. The doors open, 9 o'clock, the first panel and opening remarks. We hope to see you all there, and once again, thank you to our distinguished guests.